So it's good to be in the house of the Lord this miserable morning. The weather. I'm not anything else miserable. Just the weather is miserable. But hey, we've got to get it. We've got to get it at some point. And so I'm thankful to have a nice place to be able to worship where it's warm and dry with my brothers and sisters in Christ. Just want to bring a few announcements to your attention. If you had the newsletter, if you got your newsletter today, our greeters should be passing those out to you, and you should have received that. If not, you can pick up one on the way out. Church board members, just a reminder that we have our church board meeting this Tuesday evening at 7 p.m., and to pick up your reports. Your reports are all ready to be picked up this week, and so we encourage you to come and get those just on the way out there. Wednesday evening. Hey kids, what's happening this Wednesday?
Kids Connection.
Oh, the big kid tells me. Kids Connection, it's time, it's back. And I heard through the grapevine that a lot of people had an amazing time on Friday night. And we missed the boys shipment, but I heard it was a great evening. And there'll be more Du Bois gym nights that we're able to book for this year. Well, just into our school year. And so we were happy for that. That's something that came back that we weren't able to do all through COVID and everything, and now it's back. And we're thankful that Kids Connection is back. And so that is wonderful. And we're thankful for our seniors as well, who will be going out for a good meal on Thursday evening. Let Eleanor know. Hey, that's 55 and plus club.
I can't wait to get there.
Oh, right. And you know, I had a husband who is 6 years older than me. He still is. and so because of that, I wasn't 55 yet when I came, but I was able to grow. And so if you're 55 and older and you want to bring somebody younger along, they've never prevented that from happening. It's a great group to be a part of. They're going to be meeting at Family Traditions. Family Traditions, I believe this coming, not this Sunday, but the next, will be their last for a while. So I guess our seniors are taking advantage of it. Thursday evening at 6 o'clock. So we want to encourage you to come and be a part of that. Starting next Sunday, we had to move it 2 weeks, but starting next Sunday, on Sunday evenings, we'll have a few of these throughout the winter months. And it's kind of discipleship 101. We're encouraging you to come on out. We're going to be using the continued lay training material, and we're going to do discipleship classes together at 7 o'clock on Sundays, some Sundays. And the first one is starting October the 29th at 7. Now, we want to have some great fellowship. And even if you want to have a late supper and you want to bring something along, a few sandwiches, a few sweets, I will put the coffee and tea on, and we can have a bit of fellowship, a half an hour or so of coffee and fellowship. And then right at 7, we will start. Our aim is to have a time of worship and some study together about discipleship. So we encourage you to be a part of that. Wednesday night, Pastor Mike is starting up a new study, and it sounds quite interesting. And it's going to be about Paul's letters. And so every week we're going to look at different letters of Paul. And so this week you're asked to read before you come. Don't stay away if you haven't, but we're asking you to read, if you can, Acts chapter 17 and 19. And so if you'll read that, I'll put that up on the messenger group and remind you of that this week. If you're not part of our church messenger group, let me know, and we'd love to put you on there. That's how we keep people informed of things that happen like that. At the last minute, we're able to do that. So you can see there's quite a few things going on here, and I want to make sure I don't forget anything. Family photo and game night. That's coming up November the 4th. Mark your calendars. Saturday night at 7 o'clock. And so family, friends, babies, siblings, couples, grandparents, basically everybody, is invited to come and get together and have their photo taken. Maybe you want to have your photo taken with some friends. Bring your friends along, and you will receive an 8x10 photo. Isn't that something? I thought that. And then you get to play some games and some good, healthy competition against your friends and family and grandparents and everyone else. So bring a few items. There will be a lunch to follow, and bring your favorite games along. Kelly was supposed to be sharing this announcement, but is not able to be here today, so Edith is going to come at this time.
There were 10.5 million shoeboxes sent worldwide. There were 415,072 sent from Canada.
Wow.
PEI sent 2,720. She says, how can we be involved, fill a box, and return it by Sunday, November the 12th? If you aren't able to fill a box, but wish to donate a few items or money, you can leave it at the back, and I will be sure it goes in the box. Pray for the boxes being packed for the children who will receive them. The Philippines, Ukraine, Costa Rica, and El Salvador are some of the places boxes from Canada will go. So they're out there, and there's the pamphlets in them.
Let's stand for the call to worship of the worship band here for this morning. The difference of the Pauline letter study is that every week we will see a video clip. One of the witnesses in the letters doing a monologue how they reacted to Paul's ministry. Not all of them have a positive view. That's the twist of the study. Not just going through the letters, but looking at someone give his account of what he experienced during Paul's ministry. Our call to worship for this morning comes from Psalm 119, verses 1 to 3, 7 to 11, and 103. If you want to follow with me in your scripture Bible that's in your pew or in your hands or in your electronic device. The word of the Lord. Happy are those whose way is blameless, who walk in the way of the Lord. Happy are those who keep his decrees, who seek him with their whole heart, who also do no wrong, but walk in his ways. I will praise you with an upright heart, and I learn your righteous ordinances. I will observe your statutes. Do not utterly forsake me. How can a young man keep his way pure, or an old person keep his way pure? By guarding it according to your word. With my whole heart I seek you. Do not let me stray from your commandments. I treasure your word in my heart so that I may not sin against you. Going to verse 103. How sweet are your words, O Lord, to my taste, sweeter than honey to my mouth. Let us pray. Father, come, Holy Spirit, we pray. Come, Holy Spirit, to our minds we receive your comfort. Come, Holy Spirit, to our hearts we receive your peace. Come, Holy Spirit, to our souls we receive the Father's love for us. Father, we come before you in humbleness. We come in awe. We stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and we pray, O Lord, that you would pour out your Spirit upon us. From the youngest to the oldest, O Lord. We pray, O Lord, that you would be with the songs that we sing, that, Lord, that you would accompany the preaching of your word, that your Spirit will speak to our hearts, that we would be challenged, we will be corrected, we will be rebuked, we will be comforted. Whatever need is ours today, would you do that, O Lord, we pray? We come, O Lord, knowing that we can't save anyone, but you are the Savior, the Redeemer of all mankind. So Lord, we drop our power and energy to save the world, and we go to the one who is able, the one that is more than able to do what he has intended to be through Christ his Son. We pray these things. Come now, we pray, in your majesty and in your glory. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Good morning. Oh, good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Come, Holy Spirit. He has been invited here this morning. We're ready to hear sound. Picks up a little bit before we start singing this morning.
A little bit.
Well, it is so good to be together in God's house. As I said, the Holy Spirit is invited. Now let's invite him into our hearts and worship him this morning. First song we are going to open up by singing is Take My Life and Let Me. Let's worship him.
Take my life and let it be. Constantly pray, dear Lord.
So why would he?
gospel. I've only tried it and tested it and known it to be true. Now, I'd love to say to you today that you won't face difficulties in your life, that you won't face loss, and you won't face storms. We know that not to be true. But I'll tell you, we can have a firm foundation in the midst of all that we're going through. And I know today, even in a congregation this size, with the ones that are here, there's a lot of shaking going on. I remember many, many years ago, a missionary came, and he was in a part of the world where it was very, very difficult to even minister, to even be a missionary. And he had to even be quiet and be careful how he went about the mission work. And all hell was breaking out in the country where he was serving. But he made a statement that always stayed with me. There's a lot of shaking going on, but it's happening in order that God's unshakable kingdom might be birthed. See, we want to believe today, and that's our theme song for Joseph, and while we're working through God meant it for good, we want to believe that if we follow the Lord, as we'll look at later this morning, there won't be any issues, there won't be any difficulty, there won't be any attack, and there won't be any battles. We just smooth sailing all the way forward. And we know that's not true. But we can have a firm foundation. And so as we sing this song, I invite you to come. If you're having a lot of shaking going on right now, and you just need to plant your feet again upon the faith that you have in Jesus, that you need to make a statement today that I'm planted on the firm foundation. And no matter what happens, the winds can blow, and the waves can come and all of it, but my faith is built up in you. Maybe you need to come and pray for someone that you know is going through that. You want to come to the altar of prayer. We're just going to sing this song and invite you to come and either take a stand or kneel, and then we'll have a time of prayer this morning.
Yeah. wants to share something. I've shared it with a few educators this week, and I've talked to a few educators, and our daughter is an educator in Ontario. And there's a lot of struggles going on in the schools. There's a lot of issues. There's a lot of shaking going on in the schools and in the lives of children. We need to pray. Pastor Mike seen something, and I believe it was the Holy Spirit that showed it to us, that a scientist has been doing, these scientists have been doing examination on the brains of children today. And children today, they're noticing there's a missing part. The brain is there, but it's not firing. And where it's not firing is empathy, sympathy, care, kindness. There's a new generation that's out there that there is no empathy, sympathy, or care. I was shocked as we heard the scientists share all of that. And I thought, Lord, what is the hope for this generation? And God said, you're looking at us. The church. We're an alternative community. You think it's secondary that you bring and send your kids to youth? They're being trained in the ways of the Lord. They're going to be the ones who will shine the shining lights in the midst of the dark world because they know what it is to have empathy and sympathy and care. Because that's what Jesus would do. You think Kids' Connection is just a nice little entertainment on Wednesday night or Sunday school? I've blessed you parents that brought your kids today and continue to bring them because you are training them up in the ways of the Lord, that the Lord's favor is going to be so upon them that God is going to use them as light and salt in a dark and tasteless world. God is able to move mountains, my friends. We're not settling for what the scientists say on this generation. And so, Father, in the name of Jesus, we come and we pray today. Thank you for all the precious little ones that are a part of this church. Thank you. Already we pray forward into Wednesday night and all those kids that will come out from to Kids Connection. That I kept my heart was heavy on Wednesday night as I was praying for them and thinking about them, Lord, that it is those that are coming in underneath the tutelage of people here that are teaching them at a young age that God loves you. That God has a purpose and a plan for your life. That any time that you're going through trouble or difficulty, you can turn to Jesus. And he will give you the strength that is needed. And one day, you will have indeed with him an eternal home. God, we thank you for the message of the gospel. We thank you that Calvary's enough. We thank you today that we can pray and intercede and do all that we need to do for our community that is grieving, that is hurting. Just saw another posting again last night, Lord, another funeral. God, my heart was heavy for the broken, for the hurting, for the grieving, and continue to help the grieving of our community of faith here, Lord. May it go out from this place of worship and go down through the streets and all throughout Alberton and Northport and just all over, Lord, the care and the compassion. Thank you for the care and compassion that we have seen by from the body of Christ in the midst of hurting and brokenness. God, I believe as people start to project over the youth and the children of this day that they're coming from broken homes and they've got broken hearts and now we're finding out even broken minds, that you will help us to stand firm on that foundation of faith that you have given us and we would shine, Jesus, we would shine the light of Christ into a dark world. That we would be the salt, the flavor, in a tasteless world. That people would see something real and authentic in us and would want it. And we could give them a reason for our faith, a reason for our strength, a reason for our ability to go on and continue on despite all the tragedies and difficulties we face. You are our firm foundation. Lord, we confess today, without you we could do nothing. But with you we can do all things. All things are possible. And Lord, we even talked about mountains being moved this morning. God, there's some people in our church today that have some major mountains. God, we ask in the name of Jesus that you would move those mountains, Lord, and you would make the crooked way straight for them but even as the two were on the road to Emmaus in their grief, Jesus moved in close and walked with them. God, move in close and walk with us through these days, I pray, O God. Whatever challenge we might be facing, walk with us. For those that are doubting all of that truth today, I want to encourage you today that He is as close as the mention of His name. What have you got to lose? Call on the name of Jesus, and He will come to you. Surrender your need and your situation, and He will carry it forward. And you too will make it through. God, I thank you today for the faith that's been exercised in this place of worship today. You're going to help us, and we're going to make it through. God, I pray those that are strong in the faith would take the time this week to come around those that are weaker in the faith and walk with them and encourage them that they too will make it through. Take the blinders off, Lord. May we be people who truly do have empathy and sympathy and care and love for one another, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. God bless you. I'm going to ask Pastor Mike to come and read the scripture. He doesn't know that. That's one of the joys of being married to Christ. We just have a few verses that will come up on the screen. Didn't pick the full chapter. Genesis 39.
Joseph was handsome and good looking. And after a time, his master's wife cast her eyes on Joseph and said, "Lie with me." But he refused and said to his master's wife, "Look, with me here, my master has no concern about anything in the house, and he has put everything that he has in my hand. He is not greater in this house than I am, nor has he kept back anything from me. How then could I do this great wickedness and sin against God?" And although she spoke to Joseph day after day, he would not consent to lie beside her or to be with her. One day, however, when he went into the house to do his work, and while no one was in the house, she caught hold of his garment, saying, "Lie with me." But he left his garment in her hand and fled and ran outside. When she saw that he had left his garment in her hand and had fled outside, she called out to the members of her household and said to them, "See, my husband has brought among us a Hebrew to insult us. He came into me to lie with me, and I cried out with a loud voice. And when he heard me raise my voice and cry out, he left his garment beside me and fled outside." Then she kept his garment by her until her master came home. His master. And she told him the same story, saying, "The Hebrew servant who you brought among us came to me to insult me, but as soon as I raised my voice and cried out, he left his garment beside me and said," so I know what you're thinking, "what a liar." When his master heard the words that his wife spoke to him, saying, "This is the way your servant treated me," he became enraged. And Joseph's master took him and put him into prison. Amen. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
God, Junior Church slide should be up. It's not there, but go ahead. Anybody going off to Junior Church at this time? The littles. What age? Up to grade two today. That's a nice segue to say, if you'd like to help, the junior church for the older kids, Corinne is offering it once a month, and then if anybody would like to help with that, we invite you to speak to Corinne about that, and she'll help take care of that. Up to grade two now for junior church. So, for anyone that's not been with us, we are looking at this whole series about Joseph. And one of the things it was interesting because somebody mentioned it and we felt convicted of it. The Lord just kind of keeps us in check with that if we're not careful, we tend to always stay in the New Testament, we always tend to preach the New Testament. And we are firm believers that you cannot understand the New Testament unless you understand the Old. And so after preaching for a while from things from the New Testament, I felt convicted that we needed to back up and go back into the Old Testament. And so the story, familiar story that many of us have grown up with, the story of Joseph, we are working through the series towards the end of Genesis. It starts in chapter 37. And so we're just on the third week. And we're looking at this reality meant for good. That we started at the end of Genesis and we're working our way back. Because at the end of Genesis, Joseph got to a place where he said, what you meant for evil, God meant for good. And actually, we looked at the poem, The Divine Weaver, because the actual scripture here shows that which you wove, that's pretty premeditated. What you wove for evil, God has rewove for good. And so we began to realize that when we grew up in church and in Sunday school, we made Joseph a great hero of the faith, and he is. But in the story of Joseph, the hero is God. And that's what we're seeing as we work through this series, meant for good. So here's a question for you. See, I'm an idealist. Pastor Mike has brought that up many times, and he challenges me on that. He's very much a realist. I'm an idealist, right? If you're an idealist, it gets you into trouble all the time. Because there are no ideals. And so I found that at a very young age. I was 8. And I was in Cornbrook in the elementary school. And all of a sudden, I can't remember what was done, but somebody did something pretty bad in the classroom. And all of a sudden, the teacher said, well, the person who has done this has to go down to the principal. And I'm looking around, and the person who actually did it used my name. Now, here's how it was said, because this is really my name. Betty Lou did it. I looked. I was in shock. I didn't do a thing. I was that kid. Now, I won't go on about where I was later in my school years, but at that age, I was the kid that did whatever I was told. Behaved. I'm first born. Got my list. Cross them off. You tell me not to do it, I don't do it. And so the teacher looked at me. Then all the friends of this other girl said, yeah, she's the one who did it. And so the teacher says to me, you, Missy, need to go down to the principal's office. And so slowly, very slowly, I walk down the long halls. I can still visualize it. I knock on the door. And I go into the principal's office with the note from the teacher. That was before texting and all those things. With the note from the teacher. The teacher opens up the note. He goes into his desk and he pulls out a drawer. Some of you guys remember this. And out comes the big leather strap.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yeah. And we had to do what? And he said it was a double whammy, so I was going to get in both hands. And I remember getting the strap in both hands. And man, that hurt. But what hurt more than that was my broken spirit and my broken heart. Because I said through the whole thing, but I didn't do it. I didn't do it. It wasn't me. I didn't do it. Then I went home. Mom got the note. And then Mom opened up the note. And I said to my mom, I didn't do it. It wasn't me. And my mom said, well, they gave you the strap, so they must have given you it for something. For some reason. And she didn't believe me that I didn't do it. Sometimes in life, it seems like we can't get ahead. Sometimes in life, it seems like people are out to get us. Sometimes we can even get to a place where we're discouraged, and that discouragement can even move into depression. And I have had that time in my life. It wasn't over that, but many other things similar that you can even have suicidal thoughts. But I want to encourage you today, no matter what difficulties you are facing, God can take it to build your character and make you a stronger person. And he will use you to display his faithfulness and integrity. After an interlude focusing on Judah, and that's quite an interesting story, in Judah, in chapter 38, we now turn back in Genesis to Joseph's story, and we see it in Genesis chapter 39, as Pastor Mike just read some of the verses for us. And I like what someone says. It is a melodramatic tale about a handsome young man, a stupid husband, and a lonely wife. And someone else said Potiphar's wife was the original desperate housewife. And so last week we looked at the fact that things went bad for Joseph, even though he was God's favorite, and even though he was supposed to be heir of the family, the father's favorite, I meant to say. Now we realize that he's rejected by his brothers and he's sold into slavery. And now this week we see that he was tempted. Joseph had a traumatizing experience. Remember, he's a teenager having a traumatizing experience. But now he's at a place where he's starting, even though enslaved, he's starting to feel some stability in Potiphar's house. And so we're told that he was sold to Potiphar. And Potiphar was a person of importance in Pharaoh's court. He was an official. We mentioned it a little bit last time. He was the captain of the guard. But the actual word that Hebrew uses here, he was the captain of the butchers. Now, they weren't out cutting meat in the backyard. He was the captain of the executioners. And this is where Joseph gets sold to? The captain of the executioners? But one of the powerful things we're seeing today in this passage is the Lord was with Joseph. And he was a successful man. I like what Tyndale said when they translated, the Lord was with Joseph and he was a lucky fellow. See, there was something upon Joseph. It was called God's favor. God's favor was upon Joseph. The covenantal favor. Remember we talked about, you need to back up, and you talk about Abraham, and you talk about his father, and these promises that were made that in generations to come. We've talked about the fact today, we live for ourselves today. We don't even care about the next generation or three, four generations to come. But in those days, it was about your generations to come. It was about you having an impact, leaving a legacy, and generations to come would serve the Lord. And so promises are made to Abraham. Well, Abraham doesn't see it with the physical eye. He sees it with the eyes of faith. And God makes promises to him. And those promises are so true that Joseph now is experiencing them. And Joseph's, you can see that God's favor is upon Joseph. No matter what comes at him, no matter where he is, that covenantal blessing and favor is upon Joseph. So much so that we're told in this passage that blessing is so much on Joseph that wherever Joseph is, there's blessing around it. Because Potiphar's house begins to prosper. Think about that for a moment. Just wrap your mind around that. And I was thinking about later on that, you know, when the Ark of the Covenant is taken and stolen, and you'll read about wherever it was in whoever's house, the blessing would be on that house until it was moved on. And so there is this aspect about Joseph, that Joseph is in Potiphar's house. He's enslaved, but God pours out the blessing even on Potiphar's house because of Joseph. And what we find out is that, you know, that Potiphar seems to know it. God had promised to Abraham, I will bless those who bless you. So Potiphar recognizes this blessing, and so he gives Joseph responsibility, and then he comes to the place where he gives Joseph his whole household to take care of. So he's Potiphar's right-hand man. Potiphar left everything in his charge, but one thing. Potiphar's wife. All of this is yours, Joseph. Manage it. Take care of it as you would see fit, but don't touch that one thing. My wife. It would have been an unspoken truth. You know, that sounds very originally, doesn't it? Move all the way back to creation and then the fall. Adam and Eve had all responsibility and authority. They had the blessing of God. And God says, you can have all of it. Rule over all of it. Except, don't eat the fruit of this one tree. The rest is history, isn't it? And so, my friends, when temptation comes knocking, we see that in this passage. I like what Billy Sunday, the old circuit preacher, said. Temptation is the devil looking through the keyhole. Yielding is opening the door and inviting him in. When God's favor, I think this is an important lesson, when you are a man or a woman of integrity and God's favor and blessing is upon you, beware that people would love to take you down. The attack will come. The enemy would love you to fall. Would love that everything you sputtered from your mouth and your lip, all those things you taught kids in Sunday school, all those times that you told people, trust in God, all those times, he would love you to fall in such a way that he would try to negate everything that you said for the Lord. We've seen it happen to TV evangelists and people in very high positions, that they have fallen terribly. And the enemy would love us to fall. You need to guard your heart, my friends. You need to stand firm in your faith. And so Joseph goes through a time of testing as this temptation is knocking constantly. So James tells us, God doesn't tempt us. Did you hear me? Say that to somebody. God doesn't tempt us. Say it to somebody. God doesn't tempt us. God doesn't tempt us. Now, God can allow times where temptation can be used for a time of testing. Here's the difference. You can read the beginning of the book of James. He's very clear on the difference between temptation and testing. But just in a nutshell, as we don't have time today, a temptation is being enticed to invite you to sin. It's inviting you to get further from God and the things of God. A test is being that God is entrusting you to overcome it, to be stronger, and to do well through it. And so we see, though temptation is coming, God is using this as a time of testing for Joseph. I like what somebody said. What doesn't break you will make you stronger. And so everything went well until Potiphar's wife takes note of Joseph. We're told in Scripture that he was very well built and handsome. And so she says to him repeatedly, come to bed with me, come lie with me, whatever version you have. And she tries to seduce him daily. Did you get that? Daily, he's being seduced. And Joseph continually refuses her advances and stays clear from her. I love what we're told here. This is where you can see Joseph is a man after God's heart. Because Joseph, first of all, says to her, why he says no to her is your husband has trusted me with everything. Why would I do such a terrible thing to him? Then he gives his second reason why he will not listen to her or heed her temptations. He says, how can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? Do you realize that this is before the Ten Commandments? This is long before the giving of the law. This shows us that this young man is walking in covenant with God and has a relationship with God, and he will not sin against God. My friends, when temptation comes knocking at your door, and hey, young people, what it is ultimately is not a good time or a fun thing, and nobody will know. It is a sin against God. And we know better. We know better. Because we've been raised around it. Those who don't know, they don't know. Their families will do things that your family will never do. Because they don't know. But you know better. And he says, no, I won't sin against God. I just wanted to do a bit of a sidebar. Because even though the message today is not so much about facing temptation, I think we need to take a moment and just visit that. I like what somebody said. When you're facing temptation, you need to do, there's three things that we can learn from God's scripture. He says, learn from Eve. Don't believe the lie. See, temptation starts here, usually between your two ears. It starts right in your mind. And so since the Garden of Eden, Satan has been waging a battle for the mind. And he uses lies. Remember, he is the father of lies. And he masquerades as light. So you can see the compromise and the way he'll get you to reason things. And he said to Eve, remember that, when he said to Eve, did God really say that? God didn't say that, did he? And so the devil attacks us by tempting us to question God, or to question his word, or to question his goodness. And so the enemy will come to question us. And so temptation, my friend, starts in the mind. And so you need to be careful not to listen to the lies. Then we learn from Joseph. There are times when temptation is just knocking and knocking and knocking, and you need to run. You need to run. There are situations that people put themselves in that they should never put themselves in. If you are in a situation that is tempting, say, very nice to see you, but I'm out of here. No amens to that? If you need to be rude, you be rude, because your relationship with God is more important than what anybody else thinks. You get yourself out of that situation and you run. I remember hearing people who were happily married people, and a workplace romance starts. Oh, my husband has no time for me. My husband doesn't listen to me. But this one at work, he's easy to talk to. And before you know it, all of a sudden there's just a casual dinner together. You run. You don't entertain. When you're put into situations that would cause you, you're tempted to sin, you don't put yourself in those kinds of situations, you run. And then, praise God, we learn from our Lord Jesus Christ when he was tempted. We use God's word. Jesus met Satan's temptations with scripture. He said, go away, Satan, for it is written. Now, I'm not very good at quoting scripture. It's very good to learn scripture and to quote it, but that's not what we're talking about here. Just quoting scripture does not cause the enemy to run. Because, by the way, the enemy knows scripture. And he misuses it and abuses it. You have to live the word of God. You have to obey the word of God. It needs to be a lamp to your feet. That you walk in it and you use the word of God, and the enemy has to flee. So we can learn that in the places of temptation, as 1 Corinthians 10 tells us, God makes a way for us, all of us. He makes a way out that we will not be tempted more than we can bear. That this time of testing will make us stronger. I like this story. A man had a two-story house. He heard a knocking at the door. And he found Jesus there. And Jesus was there, and he said, Jesus, I want you to come into my house. I have a room for you up on the top floor. Go stay in that room, Jesus. Again, in the middle of the night, he heard a knocking, and when he came knocking through the door, he opened up the door just a crack, and it was the enemy. The devil was there, and the devil came in and fought with him all night. He kept screaming, Jesus, help me, Jesus, where's Jesus? Jesus isn't there. He battled all night, and he sent Jesus. He sent the enemy out through the door. He finally got the door shut. So he says to Jesus that next morning, Lord, I was calling you. Didn't you hear me? Jesus says, well, all you gave me was a room in your house. And then he says, well, Lord, let's do this. You have the top floor, and I'll have the bottom floor. Jesus says, okay. See, Jesus will not go where he's not invited. Did you get that? So Jesus has the top floor, he has the bottom floor. You can understand what happens, because the door goes knocking again in the middle of the night. The enemy is there. He opens it up a crack to see who it is. And he pushes himself in, and he battles with him all night long. And he cries out, Jesus, Jesus, come help me. Come help me. Where are you, Jesus? And finally, he gets him out through the door, and he slams that door shut. Now he's getting angry. And he says, Lord, the next morning. I don't understand. I called on you again and called on you again. And you didn't come and help me. And so Jesus says, he says that I need to be in your whole house. And he says, well, from now on, I can't just have you on the top floor. I need you in the whole house. And so he says, the whole house, Lord, is yours. The whole house is yours, Lord. I give you everything. My whole life, my home, everything. It's all yours, Jesus. Well, you know, in the middle of that night, the devil comes knocking, but guess who swings wide open the door? Jesus stands there in all authority and victory. And Satan says, oh, I guess I'm at the wrong house. Billy Graham put it this way. When Satan knocks, I just send Christ to the door. When Satan comes knocking, Christ is so much my firm foundation. He is the Lord of my life, of my comings and my goings. He is the Lord of my past, my present, my future. He is my Lord. That's what, my friends, holiness is all about. It's Jesus has the whole house. And so when Satan comes knocking, when Satan is wanting to find a place in, I remember Promise Keeper saying years ago, Satan wants to put handles on you so he can steer you around. Don't let him do it. Don't let him do it. That God has made a way out for us. And so we see now as we go back to Joseph's story, he is falsely accused. Wait a minute, Pastor. Wait a minute. Joseph stood up to temptation. He was a man of godly character. God's favor is upon him. He's a man of integrity. What are you talking about? He should be awarded for being good. No problem should come knocking at his door. That's not what we expect to hear. You see what happens next in the story. We're told all of a sudden Joseph finds himself alone in the house. You see that the writer of Genesis is trying to make a point of he was in a home where there was all kinds of servants and staff. So what it is a setup, my friends. So she sends the staff and sends them all out because she's determined that day she's getting Joseph and she's going to have him. So much so when they're left alone, she grabs hold of his cloak and even tries to force him to lie with her. And that's when I said what's important to do. Joseph runs. He runs as far away as he can get from her. But she frames Joseph. She lies about Joseph. She tells her husband when he finally comes home that he was making sport of her and trying to rape her. Now I want you to hear the story. Joseph is innocent. Did you get that? Joseph has done nothing wrong. Joseph has kept his integrity. He is a man of faith. He is a part of God's covenant. He is a person with God's favor upon him. And he is lying about it. I would like to tell you today that as a pastor, almost 35 years, that I would say to you that I've never had anyone gossip about me, that I've never had anyone lie about me, that I've never had anyone put a knife in me and turn it. My friends, it's not true. That's the big wake-up when we're off at Bible school preparing for ministry. That's why a lot of pastors aren't in the pulpit today and leave. Because somehow we swallow the lie that if we love the Lord and we're doing everything right, everything's going to be smooth sailing. It's not, my friends. But I'll tell you that everything I went through was a time of testing to see if I would not give up on the Lord. And my faith is stronger today because of it. And I believe your faith is stronger too because of it. And so here's what we don't want to hear, but this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Joseph ends up in prison. Joseph ends up in prison. Potiphar responds with burning anger, but many believe that the burning anger was not against Joseph. Guess who it was against? His wife, because he's been dealing with this for years. Now you're laughing at Pastor Wayne, 45 years yesterday for us. But this poor man, that's why we said this poor man at the beginning, I think he knew what his wife was like when he wasn't home. And I think this was probably something that she had done repeatedly, but this was different today because Joseph, a Hebrew slave, was brought into the home. And he says, no, I will not sin against God. And so she's out to get him. And I think Potiphar is burning with anger because he knew when Joseph was in his house and Joseph was in his care, God made him prosper and made him blessed. And now he's got to get rid of this Hebrew slave. And so he could have taken him out back and had an execution. Killed on the spot to make a point. He doesn't. He puts him in prison. And he doesn't put him in any prison. He puts him in Pharaoh's political prison. And so that's one of the reasons why we can see that he is angry. But even in that, God is caring for Joseph. So Joseph ends up in prison. But I want you to get this point, my friends. God was with him in prison. And so four times in this chapter 39, though we don't want to hear this lesson, we are reminded that God was with Joseph. This is, you meant it for evil, part two. You wove evil against me, Potiphar's wife, but God is reweaving it for good. See, here's the problem. This is what we've been knocking against today. If I do the right things, only good things should happen to me. There's the idealist. If I'm a person of faith, if God's favor is upon me, because I'm part of the new covenant, and I'm a part of Jesus Christ, and his blood was shed for me and I've accepted it, then nothing bad should ever come knocking at my door. Our theology is wrong, my friends. That's not what it says here. And they say that often Christians come to faith because that's how we've presented the faith to people. And the moment the problems come knocking at their door, they walk back out the church. And it's not that the gospel and the faith is wrong. It's what we've presented. That we just want to believe that if we know God and do everything right, then only good will happen to us. And it's the wrong conclusion. It's a hard lesson to learn that when we do even the right things, there are those out against us, and the enemy is roaring around. Joseph's integrity and faith cost him greatly. And he did the right thing, and he still faced hardship. But you know the difference? He faced it with God. I'm not hearing too many amens this morning. He faced hardship with God. But the Lord was with Joseph and showed him steadfast love and gave him favor in the sight of the keeper of the prison. That no matter what the world and the life tried to throw against Joseph, it would not change his relationship with God. I'm sure he had times when he said, God, why, God? I don't understand. I'm sure there were times when he got angry about it. I think that's fine because the psalmist talks about that. Even David himself wasn't impressed when things didn't go as he thought it should go. But the truth of the matter is, no matter he was questioning sometimes, God, I don't get it, I don't understand, his relationship with the Lord was intact. And he knew God was with him. And God's favor was so upon him that nothing and no one could prevent God's blessing upon Joseph's life in every situation he found himself in. And God brings his plans to fruition through what appears to be the most devastating of circumstances. Did you get that, church? God brings his plans to fruition through what appears to be the most devastating of circumstances. But we need to remain faithful. God fulfills in Joseph the promise he made to his grandfather, I will bless you, and you will be a blessing, and I will be your God, and you will be my people. My friends, the truth of it is for us. We've heard this. We say it at Christmas. We have it on our cards. Oh, a sweet little baby in a manger, and there's a cross, and we'll put Emmanuel, God, with us. And I realize after preparing for this message, we haven't really understood what that meant. That whatever we face in this world, Christ is with us. What did he promise his disciples? His last words as he commissions them. And I will be with you always. And in that night, that dark night, when we have to leave this world and enter into that world eternal, he will be with us as the good shepherd and will walk us through that dark valley of the shadow of death. And we move from life here into eternal life. Hallelujah. He is with us. No matter what we face, no matter what we go through, just like God was with Joseph. Jesus, even more so now, the Holy Spirit, God is not just outside of us. God is now inside of us. And he gives us the comfort and the strength and the reality to know that we are not alone. God's favor, my friends, if you are in Christ, the covenantal blessing is upon you as well. And God's favor is upon you. But notice in this story, it was Potiphar and the prison warden that was able to trust Joseph with everything. Here's a challenge for us today. Are we trustworthy? Are we people of such faith and integrity that those around us will be blessed because we are people blessed by God? Think about school. Think about your place of work. Think about where you volunteer. There should be a fact that you are so full of God's favor and God's covenantal blessing, and you're in such a tune with God that when you walk into a place, as the scripture says, you become the aroma of Christ. And the atmosphere in that room changes because you are there. And people will look at us and want to know about our faith because we are his and he is mine. But we must be people who live a life of integrity and character no matter what comes knocking at our door. Now I want to say something very clearly, and I need to make it known in the sound of my voice today. If you have sinned, there is an advocate. Deal with it. Take it to the cross. Take it to Christ. Have it cleansed by the blood and start fresh. I have to say that. Because scripture has made that known. If, notice it's not the norm, a life of sin. For those who are in Christ, if you sin, if you fail, if you fall to temptation, deal with it. Bring it to the Lord and be set free. And be renewed and refreshed to be able to start off again in a way that would honor him. As I close, I ask the worship team to come. Gold. I was thinking of gold and the refiner's fire as we think of this testing that Joseph is going through. And gold is one of the most valuable materials on earth, and it has been used for centuries for money. But gold has a lot of other uses in the industry, manufacturing, and even spaceflight. One of the traits that makes gold so useful is that it can be shaped and formed so easily. In fact, one single ounce of gold can be flattened out to cover 300 square feet. Did you get that? I've watched when they make that gold in the sheets. I forget the name of it now. How they pound that and pound that and pound that. All that comes from 1 ounce of gold. But gold ore dug out of the ground contains many other elements that must be removed prior to the gold being useful. The refining process for gold involves intense heat. Gold melts at a temperature of almost 2,000 degrees Fahrenheit. That incredibly high temperature is required for gold to be ready to be used, to be refined. And my friends, today, the Christian life involves much of the same process. Sometimes we are surprised when bad things happen to good people. But the scripture tells us that the fiery trials are part of God's refining process of our lives. Rather than griping and complaining when trials come, we should rejoice as we think of the end result they're going to produce in our hearts and life. I think God needs to change our prayer life. I've been challenged with that. Lord, take me out of this circumstance. Lord, this isn't fair. Lord, I don't understand what's going on. Lord, come to my aid. Lord, fix this. Maybe the Lord would say, maybe you would do okay to pray, Lord, despite the circumstances, move in my life. Change me. Prepare me for this. Make me stronger. Make me more like Jesus. That's good theology. That lines up with this. That God is wanting to give us the power that is needed to face anything in his name. And be reassured today, no matter what you're going through, what you're facing, God is with you. And he will never leave you nor forsake you. Father, this is a hard word again. I know it's always hard when it's very quiet. I don't hear too many amens. But it is your truth, and you're wanting to equip us and empower us. Even in light of recent weeks and all that's been going on in West Prince, we don't get it, Lord. We don't understand it. And we want to say to you, we don't like it. We don't like it when life isn't fair. We don't like it when we've been right and good and done what you've asked us to do and somebody comes against us, somebody lies, somebody sets up a trap. We walk into a room and we know that people are gossiping about us and saying things that aren't even true. God, we don't get it. But we're not meant to. You told us, as we've said already in recent weeks, in this world you will have trouble. But take heart. I have overcome the world. I pray today that all of those in the sound of my voice and even online today who are facing struggles, who are facing troubles, who are facing when life isn't fair, getting a diagnosis that you didn't want to hear isn't fair. Especially when we've done everything we can to keep ourselves healthy. And we get that diet. There's a lot of stuff in this life that is not fair. But I thank you today, oh God. You have promised that you are with us no matter what. Encourage those listening today. Help us to learn from Joseph's story that you want to bless us no matter what circumstance we find ourselves in. Help us to continue to be people of integrity and godly character. Help us to stand firm on that foundation that we have in Christ. And our houses will not be shaken. And we thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Stand with us as we sing this closing song. about offering someone who needs a prayer. And I know some people will say, well, this service is being recorded, but I would say to you, if you walk up to the end of the aisle, that's as far as you need to go, no one online would see it. Only your church family. I want to give you that moment. If you're saying today to the Lord and saying to the church and saying to the pastor here today, Pastor Mike and Pastor Tingley, I need him. I need an intervention. I need help. I'm under attack. I'm struggling. Would you come now at this time? We're just going to all bow our heads to give that person or persons an opportunity to be obedient to the Holy Spirit. If God has been tugging on your heart today, that's the Spirit tugging on your heart. We're just going to bow our heads and just stay, wait for a moment and just ask you to come down the aisle and stand at the end of the aisle and we will pray with you. Receive today's benediction. Therefore, do not let sin exercise dominion, Paul says, in your mortal bodies to make your obey your passions. No longer present your members to sin as instruments of wickedness, but present yourselves to God as those who have been brought from death to life, and present your members to God as instruments of righteousness. For sin will have no dominion over you, since you are not under law, but under grace. And may you go today in God's grace. God bless you.